Good afternoon, and thank you for that warm welcome. And thank you for joining me here this afternoon. You know, at IBM, we have an outstanding team focused on delivering IT security capabilities to our clients all over the world. In fact, it was just two nights ago, we were recognized by SC Magazine, who honored us with an award naming IBM as the top IT security company. Well, I'm pleased to represent that team, especially here at the 2010 RSA Conference, which appropriately proclaims itself to be the place where the world talks security. Now, this seems fitting as I'm here today to speak to you today about this ever-changing world that we find ourselves in, the future of business security, and how it really impacts the companies we work for, as well as you and I in every aspect of our lives. You know, it's really impossible to open a newspaper, turn on the TV, listen to the radio, even go on a business trip without reading, seeing, or being personally impacted with the issue of security in our lives. And it can lead to some interesting interactions. As I checked in at the airport on the way to this conference, the ticket agent asked me some standard security questions. Has anyone given you any packages that you didn't pack yourself? Well, I told him that my mother-in-law had given me a parcel that she wanted me to deliver to my wife, who was going to meet me in San Francisco. He looked at me very carefully and asked, "Does your mother-in-law like you?" Well, again, it's everywhere. And as I prepared for the keynote here today, I wanted to learn more about the Rosetta Stone, which, of course, is the theme of this event. And as you know by now, the Rosetta Stone was created by the ancient Egyptian Council of Priests in honor of the deeds of Ptolemy V. And in reading the translation of this ancient text, I was intrigued to see that security was a topic of concern and focus even back then. You know, the good king is praised for his focus on the safety and security of his people. And we might call this today strategic risk management. But according to the text, the king built great armies and a navy to protect the land from invasion. He built fortifications, incredible fortifications, to protect cities and the people from harm. And he built dams to protect the flooding of the plains. He spent great sums of money, and again, this was all to subdue things that could do harm, bring harm to the people. Now, the priests praised the king because they saw that over time, with strong security, had come strong prosperity. You know, a topic that really, I think, is timely for us here today. Now, obviously, a lot has changed in the past 2,000 years since the carving of the stone, yet much is the same. We still praise or condemn our leaders, and we worry about the prosperity and well-being of people. But fortunately, we no longer paint cave walls or have to carve text in the stone. You know, the communications of our thoughts and ideas, revolutionized by the printing press, transmitted in minutes now by the telegraph and telephone, and of course then carried into the homes of the masses through mass media, radio, and television. These things are all now completely ingrained into the fiber of our everyday lives. And again, technologies that we considered science fiction a mere 50 years ago are everyday things that we use. Mobile applications, tweeting, as possibly some of you are doing right now, Facebook and blogging. Again, but a simple fact remains. With strong security comes strong prosperity. Now, I'm sure that here on day three of this conference, I don't have to explain to you how our lives are getting more complex. The pace of change in business, politics, technology, it's all accelerating exponentially. And we're not talking about mild, episodic change. We're talking about, indeed, turbulent change, economic disruptions, cyber attacks, political upheaval, technology leapfrogs, and even natural disasters that occur without warning. Even when we anticipate change, you know, maybe driven by new partnerships, mergers, acquisitions, or other strategic management initiatives, it requires our leaders to really deal with making decisions in the face of uncertainty in order to continue economic growth and expanding stakeholder value. Well, in the face of all this uncertainty, how do we anticipate, how do we prepare for all the bad things that can happen? You know, organizations, at the end of the day, have to learn to not only embrace change, but to thrive on it in these times. Now, I believe every person in this room knows all too well the complexities and the challenges with the technology that is creating a world that's becoming ever more aware, ever more real-time, more interconnected, and indeed smarter every day. I'm sure that by this point in the conference, you've gone over every fear, every vulnerability, and all of these things that create stress in your workday and beyond, and they've been thoroughly expanded on and with good intent, because awareness is one of the things that can indeed inspire action. So this afternoon, I've come to talk instead about a vision of the future of IT security, because vision can also inspire action. Now, over the last 2 years, I'm sure you've heard IBM speak a lot about the concept we call Smarter Planet. You know, some people call this the intelligent world. Others have written about it as the Internet of Things. But the concepts are all quite similar. Our planet grows smarter because of the sheer magnitude of the data that we can collect about events and activities in our everyday lives. The ability to share that data, where billions of devices have built-in intelligence, is really what gives us the opportunity to use this data to understand and control what's happening and changing in the environment around us. Now, this year, 2010, marks the beginning of a new era. I welcome you to the decade of smart. In these next 10 years, more than ever before, you will find ways to make the collection and analysis of the data we collect actionable so that we can change the way the world works for the better. Now, these changes will happen because of the development of leading-edge capability, leading-edge software capability, because on our smarter planet, it's really software that is the power of the innovation that's changing the way that we live. And just think about the impact of software in our lives. You know, we're able to transform the utilities industry so that people only consume what they need and when they need it. For example, a leading utility provider in Spain is launching an automated energy management system that enables more than 300 industrial customers, 900 service providers, and 11,000 households to better control their energy usage. Users will be able to establish consumption protocols to minimize their electricity usage in peak periods and take full advantage of renewable energy resources when they're available. Now, this is an example of how software is helping utilities add a layer of digital intelligence to the grids that they operate today. These smart grids use sensors, meters, digital controls, and analytic tools of all types to automate, monitor, and control the two-way flow of information around energy across their operations, literally from the power plant to the plug. Now, these smart grids, again, allow a power company to optimize performance, prevent outages, restore outages, and allow consumers more control over their energy usage right down to networked appliances. Now, of course, solutions like this naturally raise concerns around privacy and safety. Greater efficiency relies on better data, but that's often the most sensitive data that we have available. Greater control relies on better access to these meters, for example, and all the devices installed on the power consumer's premises, but it also opens up new avenues for criminals, a whole new wave of denial of service attacks. Now, the smarter planet also means that we have to be smarter about these issues, and it means that we've got to build security and privacy controls into these systems, not as an afterthought, but right from the beginning. I'll come back to this thought. Now, some of you may have seen IBM Smart Grid solution, security solution, that we've been demonstrating here in the Solution Showcase. This is an example of how we're assisting specific industries, in this case utilities, to invest in advanced technologies that can transform their business while addressing the security, privacy, safety, and risk issues that arise from these innovations. Now, the same pattern shows up in other industries. We can easily these days figure out the best way to get from point A to point B. But if you happen to be in Singapore, the Singapore Land Transportation Authority is improving what is already one of the most modern, affordable, and heavily used public transport networks in the world. They're doing this by adding an integrated payment option that can be used for the bus or the train, parking, or even congestion control charges. And in the background, the system studies usage data to help design new schedules and dynamically route traffic so that it will further reduce congestion. Again, this is a great system, but it's also clearly operating on very, very sensitive data, collecting detailed information on who is traveling where. Privacy and user control must be built in these solutions from the beginning. And the Transportation Authority had to find a way to control access to this financial data, as well as the sensitive logistical data about the travel habits of individuals and their activities. Now, this connected world we live in has also given us an ability to access the brightest minds of our time, literally from anywhere. Great example here is in medical imaging, where a system designer has developed technology that enables medical professionals to view medical images, x-rays, CT scans, MRIs, via wired and mobile devices, including laptops and smartphones, literally from anywhere. Now, this allows doctors who are not physically present to be able to lend their expertise and provide medical assistance and insight, which is really enabling breakthroughs for the medical profession. But the designer of this system had to find ways to ensure compliance with access to personal medical data, test results, and images that are being broadcast over public networks and to common devices. We now have the ability to access the security capabilities themselves from anywhere in the world. Indeed, at this very moment, IBM is remotely monitoring the security status of companies like many of those represented in this room with software provisioned from the cloud from one of our service operations centers around the world. You know, this capability is enabled by our secure web gateway technology, which is software that allows us to continue to blur the lines between businesses, their partners, their service providers through data sharing and hosted cloud-based services. You know, this drives new innovations in the way that we can deliver security, like the Secure Web Gateway Managed Service that we also demonstrated here at RSA. Again, this is all driven by software. Software that's allowing us to drive these innovations. And now, with advanced software and analytic tools, we have the capability to extract value from data to see patterns, correlations, and outliers. We can uncover hidden patterns in data to analyze, predict, and control events. You know, problems can be recognized and remediated before it is too late. Again, behind every one of these examples is a business, a government, or an industry that's looking at unique, innovative ways to leverage software. Today, more than ever before, these organizations are using software to enable every facet of their business. But again, we all know that there are many challenges here. Technology has allowed us to move, you know, beyond physical locations and branch offices. It allows us to live in virtual worlds across dispersed teams and players and continents. But the more data and information organizations make available to audiences, the greater the risk profile associated with this access. And as a result, is a new set of needs that have emerged. And so what is it that has changed about security risk management in this new, smarter world? Well, human beings are becoming more and more dependent on security in our everyday lives. and security is appropriately now seen as a right of every individual. It's top of mind on our customers, driven by what we call the three C's: complexity, cost, and compliance. Now, we're gathered in this room today because a smarter planet is by definition a more complex planet. More connected things driven by more software innovation, and we must ensure that organizations are proactively identifying all the types of risks to business and that we have security and resiliency plans that are in place to address any kind of threat or disruption. You know, complexity is indeed a security issue. It's a security issue that is here to stay. Why? Because complexity creates shadowy places where people with bad intentions can do a lot of damage. Complexity creates vulnerabilities. We cannot have a smarter planet without understanding the risks associated with all the new capabilities and services that we're going to build and depend on to drive innovation around the world. Now, there's a very simple concept here that I want to communicate as we're dealing with issues like cybersecurity, protecting critical infrastructures, or even dealing with the issues of privacy and identity. In all cases, we've just got to be ahead of the bad guys. We have to design security into the services from the beginning that will deliver and drive a smarter planet. Now, this is the essence of what we're trying to do at IBM. And again, we're doing this with the thought in mind that I mentioned earlier. I want you to remember that with strong business security, we believe will come strong prosperity. Now, to stay ahead of the bad guys, you've got to be able to see what's happening with the infrastructure from a service operations perspective and a security operations perspective. You have to be in control. In a controlled environment, we strive to make sure that everything is in an understood, desired state, all of these connected capabilities that drive the smarter planet. You have to be able to visualize what's happening right now in that desired state, and you have to be able to make sure that you stay within defined control limits and understand the risks that are associated with moving in and out of these control limits. Now, control also requires automation, because we've seen in our work with clients worldwide that vulnerability surfaces from people choosing not to follow repeatable defined processes. Now, there's a very powerful value proposition that really I'm talking about here, and it resonates with businesses, industries, and governments all across the planet. This value proposition is called service management. At our Pulse conference last week, we deeply examined this notion of integrated service management that really connects all of the silos of infrastructure that are required for service delivery. This idea resonates with our clients because it's a real value proposition with a core premise. The most important things that our clients do with the technology infrastructures they deploy is deliver a service that supports the business process that at the end of the day is important to a business outcome. And that's what's really important about the service from a security perspective. That service is built on a set of physical assets with built-in intelligence. It's storing, processing, or collecting huge amounts of information that are all network connected. It's important to note that these intelligent connected assets really span multiple asset classes. It's not just IT stuff. It can be transportation vehicles, traffic control devices. It can be buildings. And, of course, it's the digital assets like design documents or, indeed, the software applications that supports composite applications. All of these things are now part of the smarter services that we are delivering and will be delivering. Now, a key element of the smarter decade will be the capability to manage all these assets across all of this spectrum with an integrated set of software capabilities, because you have to see what's happening with the entire infrastructure, again, whether it's from a service operations perspective or a security operations perspective. Integrated service management also includes the integration of processes and best practices from different sources, different areas and domains like ITIL, the IT Infrastructure Library, or COBIT, or of course ISO 27001 from a security control perspective. The integration of these best practices allows organizations to make sure that they're functioning properly within a set of control limits to deliver the services that are expected or even mandated in an increasingly interconnected and complex and intelligent world. So at IBM, we talk to our clients about this idea of integrated service management in some ways as the operating system for this idea of the smarter planet. We speak with them about the idea of a service lifecycle in which you think about how you will deal with service quality and vulnerabilities at the time you're creating the services. We speak to our clients about automating the processes, visualizing status in production, and controlling desired state. Now, interestingly, while it's been found that organizations today will turn to any number of best practices for guidance on which controls to implement, again, this can be driven by regulations, it can be driven by industry, geography, or even corporate culture. What we found is that it is adherence to the disciplines of integrated service management that we see setting the highest performers in the areas of security management apart. Integrated service management is key to securing the new services that we will create in this decade of smart. It drives down the cost and cost of implementing and maintaining service infrastructure, but it also minimizes human error, and it provides data and insights to measure and to prove compliance. It's also integral to the creation of software in the development process, resulting in, again, security that's built into applications we use that create the new services that we're talking about. You see, every business and every government, regardless of their industry or home continent, will need strong integrated service management capabilities to deliver things like smarter bridges, smarter utility grids, smarter farms, smarter waterways, and even smarter banks. So at IBM, we're focused on this area of innovation. Each year, we fund extensive research in the areas of integrated service management and especially in IT security with the goal of improving the security aspect of integrated service management and addressing these inhibitors to deploying the smarter services. In fact, we think of this whole notion as smarter security. We work directly with clients and business partners, like many of the organizations represented here, to test and implement the breakthroughs that we're all driving in integrated hardware platforms, encryption, risk analytics, and overall security architecture. Now, the decade of smart calls for highly refined security risk analytics. Successful risk and fraud analytics that require really three very important elements. At the core is trusted data. Second, it's all about quality analytics. And third, it's about the ability to disseminate these analytics to the correct decision makers in support of the business processes and outcomes that they drive. At IBM, we're looking to advance this state of the art, and we're working with advanced risk calculators to provide faster processing up to 15 to 20 times today's models, even in multi-tenant architectures like cloud computing. Our researchers are working on smarter cybersecurity technologies aimed at providing a smart and a scalable way of monitoring all of the environments that we need to understand. Today's security controls and management systems do a fair job at enabling enterprises to get a better handle on their security posture. But they also create, as we all know, a multitude of event alerts, streams, as well as logs and audit records. All of these things contain precious intelligence, but far too often they're insufficiently mined or analyzed. So this inability to consolidate and correlate all of these service-affecting event and log data, and to do so at wire speeds, is really, and then present it to the proper people who can perform the analysis and do so in a semantically meaningful manner, all of this robs security analysts and administrators the valuable tools that they need to defend enterprise networks. You know, our researchers are working on ways to exploit this existing instrumentation so we don't have to ask our clients to redo a lot of the instrumentation in today's networks and data centers. We're working with this existing instrumentation to create semantically rich interpretations of security and network events through the application of streaming analytics that scale to extremely large networks, networks well beyond the networks that we see in today's organizations. Now, this will enable full correlation of all service-affecting events across the security domain, the user domain, and the full network domain. This technology interactively creates and automatically checks behavioral models for malware detection in real time, providing pre-fraud detection with extremely low false positive rates. You know, the smarter cybersecurity effort that I'm talking about here aims to put comprehensive and accurate control back into the hands of real decision makers, such as security analysts, by taking over repetitive and manual tasks and enabling these analysts to focus on remediating issues as they come up and guiding the driving of a framework that is a real, secure, tight feedback loop. Now, we also continue to research and test new and more robust and focused approaches to enterprise security. We're really delighted that one of our breakthroughs recently resulted in the International Association of Privacy Professionals honoring IBM Research as one of the top privacy innovators in 2009. It did this because IBM has developed a landmark data encryption technique called fully homomorphic encryption, which has, quite frankly, eluded researchers worldwide for more than 30 years. Our technique removes a major roadblock in encryption mathematics and paves the way for advanced research for future services that require deep and unlimited analysis of encrypted information without sacrificing any confidentiality. What this means is that service providers using leading-edge delivery models like cloud will need this type of encryption to be able to store confidential electronic data of others and to be able to fully analyze that data on their clients' behalf without expensive interaction with clients, and without seeing any of the client's private data. Now, in the future, this technique will allow companies, governments, really individuals, to store their most sensitive and secret proprietary information literally anywhere on any cloud, and they'll have the ability to access it at their convenience all the time while it remains completely secure and private. Now, these research projects that I've gone over here are all examples of areas we believe are going to be critical to the introduction of more advanced yet secure services that are an outgrowth of this smarter planet idea. These capabilities, again, as we talk about them here today at this conference, are really going to help us address these issues of complexity. And it's really, you know, this impact of the Rosetta Stone idea that has inspired us here. We wondered if, in fact, there was a way that we could help all of you, all of the audience, gain more insight into this journey that the decade of smart will take us all on. And so today, I'm pleased to announce the creation of the IBM Institute for Advanced Security. This is an institute that is aimed at enabling cybersecurity innovation and collaboration across multiple entities. This will be directed by Dr. Charles Palmer. Some of you know him very well. He's one of our most famous researchers in security. And the Institute will bring IBM security expertise to governmental organizations, our partners, academia, our clients, and all of these organizations that are involved in better serving the public sector. The Institute will be supported by IBM's security scientists, our researchers, the X-Force, our consultants, and they'll organize briefings on advanced technology and strategies for us to make sure that we provide the thought leadership on the issues that the cybersecurity community is facing around the world. I encourage all of you to visit the IBM Institute for Advanced Security online and to reach out to any of your IBM contacts to learn more about how you and your organizations can participate. So in conclusion, let me say that it is IBM's opinion that the most successful enterprises in this decade of smart will embrace service management with smarter security as the foundation for their business processes. And those that do so will be able to seize the new opportunities to innovate securely and cost-effectively. However, you can't move to a paradigm like smarter security by yourself. It's just too big of a job. You need partners who can help you get there, partners who can deliver the technology, the business expertise, and the global service capabilities to achieve smarter security. And that's one of the reasons that we're all here today, to share ideas, to share insights that will help us achieve strong security. Because I think the lessons of the Rosetta Stone have taught us that, and we've known this for thousands of years, with strong security will come strong prosperity. I wish all of you great prosperity and a safe journey home, wherever that may take you. Thank you, and have a great afternoon.